the Lord. Welcome home, church. It is good to see all of you here as we gather to worship our God. And we at St. Paul's are here for a reason. God put us here for a purpose. And we are here to build the home and
change the world.
Yes, we are. And everything we do is going to center around those priorities. I got a few announcements here. First of all, mark your calendar. We have set a date when Pastor Ray is going to, it's not even really a retirement, because it's basically like he's going to be able to do whatever he wants to do whenever he wants to do it. So whatever we're going to call that is going to happen on, get him off the payroll. There we go. Okay. June the 5th, that's going to happen at 4 p.m. So we're going to have a huge, huge shindig for this. He says it's going to be a small thing, but it's not. So save the date, June the 5th at 4 p.m. at Decatur Conference Center and Hotel. We begin Transform today. Hopefully every one of you got one of these little bookmarks that says Transformed. On the back, you can find some Bible verses. And each one of those Bible verses is going to correspond to the topics that we cover for the 7 weeks. And so there you can see that 2 Corinthians will be our verse today. You can use that. And Transform does begin today. So if you want to start your daily devotionals in our Transform book, do one tonight if you haven't done it already. Our small groups also start today and throughout this week. So figure out when your small group is, what time that meets, and we're going to begin session one of our small groups here this week as well. If you've pre-ordered a book and you haven't picked it up, grab one at the Transform table. Any questions, any help you need, they can help you out there. Finally here we have a next update. Oh, I have two more here. Next update. In just about a month, it'll mark our first 1 year towards giving towards our next capital campaign. The cross tower's going up. If you haven't peeked in that window and seen what's happening in the room back there, do so on your way out. There is a whole lot of cool stuff happening right now. The lights are going to go up pretty soon on the driveway. We'll be able to see where we're going. And I just wanted to announce that as of the end of March, a month ago, we had a total of 1,178,000 that have already been contributed. So give yourselves a big hand. I am amazed at the generous hearts that are here at St. Paul's. And I do want to say that the faster all those pledges keep coming in, the more we can get done now. We can get a whole lot of things done this year if you guys want to, up your generosity even a little bit more. I'm just throwing it out there for you. Okay. The last thing I wanted to announce here was that Joel Witt, who had received the call to be the elementary K-8 principal over at Lutheran School Association, he has accepted the call. And so he will be joining us. We thank God for that. So keep him and his family in your prayers as they begin to make these transitions as well. If you're a guest of ours, welcome. We're so pleased. And you could not have come at a better time. We are beginning Transform today. We are going to launch into this, and God is going to do some amazing things among his people here at St. Paul's. And you're welcome to come along for the ride. Let's all stand up and welcome each other to worship this morning.
Amen. And it is good, Lord, to be here. It is good to gather together as God's people. And it is good to get to be pastor slash guitar player Doug, because we have such an awesome pastoral team that we get to do that. And I am so blessed to serve not only with those men, but for all these people standing up here. And I want you to know that all of these musicians and many more gave their Saturday up to better themselves at their singing or at their playing so that we could grow stronger in our commitment to making worship a greater thing here among God's people. And we took a step back and thought about the why we do this. Because as we gather together, this is what matters most. that we get to step into the presence of our God, that we get to honor his name, and we get to give him everything. I think about the fact that where we are standing right now, that not that long ago, it looked exactly like it did on the other side of these walls in the main warehouse, and that where we are now has been radically changed. That this was excavated, it was scooped out, and a place of worship was established. And I know that God is more than willing to do that with our lives. If he can do that with this space, he can do that with the space that is this flesh and bone. And God wants to do his work in us. And he comes here today to do business with each one of us. And I pray that our hearts are open to receive his transformative power. And so we call on the name of this God. We make our beginning in the name of the Father and of the Son and of the Holy Spirit. Let's sing together.
Jesus, we're alive. I just love the phrase in that song, we don't want to leave until we're changed. You know, it kind of reminds me, have you ever heard the phrase, I'm going to keep doing it until I get it right. I know when we're practicing songs and somebody does something wrong, nope, stop, stop, start over, do it again, do it again. Maybe you've taken up a new hobby and you're really passionate about a new sport. Maybe you've played that game where you go get a bag of clubs and you take this little ball and you whip this club up and you take a few swings and it looks so easy, but you can't even hit the ball. And you say, I'm gonna do it and I'm gonna do this and do it again till I get it right. So you keep trying and you keep trying and finally you're hitting the ball every single time, but maybe it's going to the left and maybe it's going to the right. So you say, I'm gonna do this again until I get it right. And you set a new goal. And I'm going to keep hitting it until I can make it go straight. And so you do it again, and you do it again until it's going straight. It's not going very far, so you set a new goal. I'm going to keep doing it and doing it again until I can hit it 250 yards. And you practice and you practice until you've done it. And then you're working on your handicap. Mm-hmm. Well, that, my friends, is transformed. And it is no mistake that we are starting week one with our spiritual health. And if we look at our scripture for this morning, you'll see what happens when you align yourself with Christ. From 2 Corinthians chapter 5, verse 17, let's read this together. This means that anyone who belongs to Christ has become a new person. The old life is gone. A new life has begun. Whoever belongs to Christ has become a new person. That old life is gone, and a new life has begun. Let's pray together. Father, you know each person in this room by name. People who couldn't be more different, yet you love us each the same. You know each one of our strengths, our weaknesses, our struggles, and you can see clearly what most needs transformed in each of our lives. As we take on our struggles and try to make changes, oftentimes by ourselves, you wait so patiently, and you love us unconditionally, and you never change. Lord, I pray that today would be the beginning of something new, a willingness to let you guide us, a new connection to you, to your word, and to your will for our lives. In Jesus' name. Amen.
Nothing will change if all the plans I make go wrong. Your love stays the same. Your light will guide me through it all. I'm hanging on. I'm leaning
journey we're beginning today. Amen. You may be seated. I'm sorry, I forgot what I was supposed to do next. Grace is a wonderful thing. This week for Transformed, as we begin our kickoff, we've invited Michael Peer to come and share his heart about what God has done to transform his life, just for us to be encouraged in our walk of faith as he shares his.
Good morning, friends. I've been asked to share how my life has changed through my relationship with God in 3 minutes or less. I get 10% of the sermon today. The story starts a long time ago. At some point in my, probably my late teens, I made a decision that I didn't need God in my life, and things kind of went downhill from there. Fast forward several years, and I found myself living in my bedroom of this big house, and I was drinking myself basically into unconsciousness every day, because that was the only way that I could deal. I couldn't deal with life, and the only escape was literally to be unconscious. And I hated who I'd become. I was a failure as a husband, as a failure as a dad, and probably not much of an employee. But at this point in time, I wasn't asking God for help. God wasn't a thought. I mean, to say I was alone would be completely accurate. I mean, I had created this. I made this mess in my life. But God intervened, and through a series of events, I walked into a meeting of Alcoholics Anonymous for the first time, very reluctantly, to say the least. But I had no choice. I'd given up. And that's kind of what this story is. It's multiple times I give up, and I don't have a solution. I walked in there, and something amazing happened. I had no idea what I was getting into. But the amazing thing is that I haven't had to take a drink since that day. And it's got nothing to do with Michael Peer. It's got everything to do with God. Within 2 to 3 weeks, I came to the realization that the only way that I could stay sober was through God. More than 12 years of not having any use for God in my life, I know that that's the only way. And at that time, it was just the drinking. I mean, that was the part of my life that I saw as a problem, so I gave it to him. I also, at that point, I started praying, and that was a big step. It was a step. It seems like a small step, but it was a small step with huge, huge benefits, and that's another theme of this talk. I've continued that to this day. That's the one thing that I've done consistently and done right in all these years. So fast forward to a couple years later, and I'm still doing the AA thing, but I want to learn more about God, and I know that I have to come to a church somewhere to get that. Problem was, I had no idea where to go, and at that point in time, I wasn't really interested in walking in any place by myself. God intervenes again, and I wound up walking into St. Paul's for the first time and sitting back there somewhere. And Pastor Ray's laying it down that morning, and he said, I don't know what he said. I think the topic was, Michael, pay attention. This is for you. I don't know when the last time when I'd quit going to church, but I literally got hooked, and I went through the basics. I immediately joined a basics class and became a member on paper of St. Paul's, and I sat down there in the front row, and I just learned, and I learned, and I learned. And it was 1 hour a week, and that's what I was doing, and I was just learning just that 1 hour a week. But once again, it was a big leap in my life from what I'd been doing before. On the AA side, I'd learned early on that I had all this time on my hands since I wasn't drinking, and I was coerced, kind of like in AA, they do it around here too. They coerce you into doing things if you were willing. And I started doing service work, just helping out whenever things needed to be done. And it's something I enjoyed. And what I found later on was it kind of broke my self-centeredness, because me sitting around doing what I wanted, which is what I always thought, if I did what I wanted, I would get the happiness and I would get what I wanted, I'd be happy. Well, what I found was the exact opposite. When I did what I wanted to do, I was miserable, and that's what I got. But focusing on you or anybody else, just doing for others, was abundantly blessed me, and that was a big, big step for Michael Peer. Fast forward a couple more years, and sitting there for an hour a week just growing. I went to a Bible study, a pastor-led Bible study, and I sat way on the end by myself, minding my own business. I just wanted to learn and not talk to anybody. And then Della Miller and her crew sat down next to me, and they sucked me right in. And I'll say that's when I became a member of St. Paul's, because that's when people started loving me, and I was able to start loving other people. And I didn't know anything about the Bible, and they didn't care. They just wanted me there, and they nurtured me, and it was wonderful. Once again, a huge, huge step. Seems like a small, small little thing, but a huge step. And I kept doing that. A couple years later, I got to know Eric Altburn a little bit, and I talked to him about Bible study and how great I thought it would be to do that on a daily basis to start my day. And he simply suggested getting up a little bit early and reading a book, get in the Bible, and just read something. And I started doing that. A small change in my daily routine, but a big change in who I was, and it's something that I've continued to do to this day. And I mean, it's little things that I've done, and there's no way I would take credit for these changes. It's just stuff that has been put on my heart, and I've reluctantly made changes, and then I just get blessed abundantly. I mean, many other things have happened. I've got involved with a men's ministry. God's clearly put it on my heart to do something. I don't know what it is, but it's going somewhere. And I'm doing this. There's some seasoned guys, I'll say, on Thursday mornings. They get together and do a Bible study, and these guys are probably 10 to 35 years older than me, and I get to spend a little bit of time with them on a weekly basis, and it's for me, it's an amazing thing. It's just amazing, because one more, I'm in a word, and I'm growing and I'm changing. To go from where I was to where I am now, I mean, it's taken many years with little step changes, partially because I'm not willing to ask for help. In the past, I wasn't, and it took that coercion, but it's something that's becoming easier and easier for me. And I've got an amazing life now that's full of struggles, but I also know that I've got a ton of people around to help me, and it's all coming from Him. And I know whatever I have going on, it's going to get me through it. I just, today, when we saw that, the verse, it struck me this more right here. That's what has happened in my life, and it continues to happen in my life. I'm not done by any means. I've got far, far more to do, but for now, it's pretty good. That's all I got. Thank you.
Thank you, Michael. It is one of my greatest joys in life to watch God get a hold of people and radically change who they are. And I believe that every one of us is looking for something or someone to make a difference in our lives, to come in and make what is for all of us a difficult life somehow, some way, work just a little bit better. Let's take a moment and watch this clip from one of the greatest movies ever filmed.
The flooding tunnel's over that ridge. We'll get in that way.
What was your job when you were based here?
Sanitation.
Sanitation? Then how do you know how to disable the shields?
I don't. I'm just here to get Ray.
People are counting on us. The galaxy is counting on us.
Solo, we'll figure it out. We'll use the Force.
That's not how the Force works. Oh, really? You're cold?
Han Solo is a wise man. Our families are counting on us. Our marriages are counting on us. Our kids are counting on us. There are people all around us who have no relationship with God, and their eternal lives are counting on us. Now, I have heard so many ideas on spirituality from so many different corners of our culture. I've heard more and more people say, well, I'm not religious, I'm spiritual, and they're just making it up as they go along. There is an avalanche of bad advice on how to grow spiritually and become healthy, and sometimes I just want to grab people and scream in their faces, that's not how spiritual health works. Only as we learn the will of Jesus for our lives and, I repeat, and put it into practice can we bring about true health and wholeness and whole life transformation. Welcome to Transform, church. And now I thank God that my poorly kept secret that I am a huge Star Wars nerd is finally out there, and it's like a whole burden off my shoulders here. That will not be the last Star Wars clip you see in church. This weekend we begin part one, and we are looking at seven key areas of life, and we are inviting each and every one of you to stop doing it your way. To stop doing it the world's way and exchange those ways for God's way, His perfect and power-filled way of operating in these, the most important areas of your life. Romans chapter 12, verse 2, that tiny, tiny print, I hope you can see, it's probably on your bulletin as well, it's right up there. That's going to serve as our key verse for these entire 7 weeks. Let's just read that out loud together really quick. It says, be transformed by the renewing of your mind. You see, the way that you think determines the way that you feel. And the way that you feel is going to determine the way that you act. Your feelings are fuel for your behavior. Whether it's good or bad, we act out what we're feeling in our hearts. And we think that's it. Well, I feel this way, so I have to do this. I'm upset, so I have to act upset. But your thoughts are the things that actually determine what fuel you are putting in to this finely honed body, mind, and spirit. You see, if you want to make great change in your life, you can't start with your feelings. You can't even start with your behaviors. You must start with your thoughts. If you're acting depressed, it's because you're feeling depressed. And we usually just stop right there. Well, I'm just feeling this way. And, you know, I got to do it. I'm going to act out on this. And we are slaves to our feelings. We're anger or frustration, all these things. We feel some way and we become slaves to these. But the key, my friends, the key to owning your own life, the key to radical transformation is taking it one step further and realizing that somewhere along the way, you made a rational choice. You made a choice to think depressing thoughts, and that led to your depressing feelings, and that led to your depression. If you can change the way you think, that will change the way you feel, and that will change the way you act. Got it? All right. If you can change the way you think, that will change the way you feel, and that will change the way you act. Got it? All right, good job. Now we're going to take this Romans 12:2 principle and we're going to apply it over the next 7 weeks to all these different areas. Physical, mental, emotional, relational, financial, and vocational. And today we're going to start where we need to begin by looking at how to be transformed spiritually. Transformation changes us from emptiness to fullness. It changes us from defeat and failure to fullness and victory. Transformation is the only pathway God has invented to live the abundant life that He has created all of us to live. So let's dig in today to this spiritual health. The further you are away from God, the more trouble you're going to experience in life. The more trials you will face, the more difficulties will come your way, and the more stress will consume your life. You may not believe it, but I have seen it, and God has promised that it's true. The further are you away from Him, the worse your life gets. When you stop cooperating with the Creator, the more you bump into every sharp corner that this universe has to offer. Proverbs says it like this. It says, good judgment wins favor, but the way of the unfaithful, those who have decided, I don't need God, I'm going to make up my own rules, this way leads to their destruction. No faith life equals no fun. But on the other hand, the closer I get to God, the more transformation I will experience. If I just give Him a little bit, I will experience a little bit of transformation. And if I give Him my whole life, I'm going to experience a radical, life-altering transformation. The more of God's abundant life will be mine, the closer I get to Him. When Paul met Jesus face to face, he had a life-transforming experience. He was transformed from a religious terrorist who went around murdering people into an apostle who wrote the greatest love poem that the world has ever seen. The prophet Isaiah was transformed from a person suffering clinical depression, he was always overwhelmed by life, into a courageous overcomer, unafraid to go and do for God whatever God laid on him because he got close to God. Moses got so close to God that he was even transformed in his appearance. He had to wear a veil over his face because one day God passed by and Moses saw the hem of his robe and his face began to glow. God's light transformed him physically. Now, we all here want to get close to God. And I know this because the world doesn't expect anyone to spend their weekends going to church anymore. You are all here by choice, hoping to experience what only God can give to you. I mean, unless your spouse or your parents made you be here. But we're so glad that you're here too. But no matter why you're here, one thing is true for all of us, that all of us, like sheep, have strayed away. We have all left God's paths and followed our own. Now, you don't have to teach a sheep to drift away, do you? They will wander away all by their own nature. And a shepherd has to go. Someone has to go and find them and then bring them back. Sheep will wander off a cliff if you let them. Sheep will wander into a wolf's den. Sheep have an uncanny ability to complicate their lives by making bad choices. Amen? How many sheep do we have in the house today? That's what the Bible says. It says that all of us are like sheep, lost and wandering. We all need to be transformed into something else. And the only way to get that transformation is to draw near to God, come close to Him. And so we need to start by asking just a few questions. If I need God to transform myself from a wandering sheep into something else, how do I get close to God? And when I figure that out, how do I stay there? Because I'm always like, oh, God, take this, and then I'm taking it back. Take this, I'm taking it back. And after we've fallen away from God, if you're in a place right now where He is just seeming so far away, how do I get all the way back into His presence? We are powerless over sin. We are powerless. You may not believe this, but it's true. You are powerless over other people. Just try and control somebody. Try and control a baby. They won't even listen to you. Amen? Over there, I love babies. All right. You're powerless over circumstances and world events. We are powerless over politicians. Can I get an amen? We are powerless over almost everything in life. But we have one who has all power. We have a relationship with Almighty God, and the power that you need, the power that I need to change our lives comes from that relationship, comes from that closeness to God. And the Bible has a beautiful story about how all of this works. Many people call it the prodigal son. I like calling it the story of the loving father because he's the hero. And we're going to read it, and then we're going to pull out some principles here this morning. The story goes like this. To illustrate the point further, Jesus told them this story. A man had two sons. The younger son told his father, "I want my share of the estate now, before you die." So the father agreed to divide his wealth between his sons. A few days later, this younger son packed all his belongings and moved to a distant land. And there, he wasted all his money in wild living. That's speaking to some of y'all, right? About the time his money ran out, a great famine swept over the land, and he began to starve. He persuaded a local farmer to hire him, and the man sent him into the fields to feed the pigs. The young man became so hungry that even the pods he was feeding the pigs began to look good to him. But no one gave him anything. When he finally came to his senses, somebody say, came to his senses. He said to himself, "At home, even the hired servants have enough food to spare. And here I am dying of hunger. I'm going to go home to my father and I'm going to say, 'Father, I've sinned against you and heaven, and I'm no longer worthy to be called your son. Please, just take me on as a servant.'" So he returned home to his father, and while he was still a long way off, because his dad was standing there waiting, hoping beyond hope that his son might someday come back, his father saw him coming and filled with love. Somebody say, filled with love. And compassion, he ran to his son. He embraced him and kissed him. And he said to his son said to the father, "I've sinned against heaven and you, and I'm no longer worthy." And the father wasn't even listening to him. The father said to his servants, "Quick, you bring out that robe because my son is freezing to death. Put a ring on his finger and sandals on his feet. Kill that fat calf and we are going to party down tonight." Yeah. What a story. It's our story. This is the story of all of us, because all of us tend to wander away and do what it is that we want to do. We wander away from our loving Father. We wander away from the God who created us for so much more. And this kid, he starts off bad. He starts off making demands because he wants the father to give him all of the resources so that he can satisfy whatever selfish desire is on his mind. He has an attitude of give me my now. If you got little kids, you've heard that before, right? If you got a spouse, you've heard that before, right? Give me mine. Because that's where we all begin. We come to our God and we say, give me mine now. Have you ever thought about what your prayers sound like lately? Are you praying, oh God, give me mine now? So he takes his father's resources. And he sets off for the lost Jerusalem strip. And he spends his money and his time and his energy on booze and sex and living way beyond his means. And he wastes everything. He loses it all. He becomes homeless. And then Israel hits a recession. And this makes matters much worse for the guy, because there's no more free ride. There's no friends to you know, limp him along, because everybody is tightening their belts. He can't find a decent job. And so he takes the only one he can find, slopping pigs. Now, slopping pigs is not a good profession for a nice Jewish boy, if you know what I mean, right? It's not exactly kosher to be hanging out with the pigs. But he's hungry, and he is desperate. He's so desperate that the pig slop even starts to look good to him. But not even that was on the agenda for this nice little Jewish kid. And then he finally hits the bottom. He finally receives the gift of desperation. And that gift, some of you know what I'm talking about. It has brought so many of us humbly back into a relationship with God that has changed us. Anybody there with me? Amen. His desperation is the thing that finally wakes him up. When he finally came to his senses, he said to himself, "Oh, at home there's servants and they're eating like crazy. And I have nothing. I'm dying of hunger. What's going on here?" Come to your senses means that your brain finally starts to work again. You can think about something other than just yourself. And for some of us, that's a brand new experience. And for some of us, we're not even there yet. He thinks. Somebody say, thinks. He thinks to himself, I know I don't deserve forgiveness and love, but my dad is so good. He is so good. Maybe he'll look past the fact that I took half of everything he's ever spent his life accumulating and I wasted it. And maybe, just maybe, he'll find a place for me. Not in the house, but maybe somewhere outside the house. And you know the rest of the story. And from this story, this beautiful story, we are given four things that we need in our lives to get back to God. Now, I don't know where you're at. Maybe you are far from God. Maybe you're just feeling like, you know, it's not as good as it should be. Maybe you feel recently disconnected from God and you're starting to have some serious doubts. Maybe you don't even know where you are with God right now. But if your relationship with God needs to come back online, or maybe it needs to get powered up for the very first time, these are the four things that you need to do. Number one, you need to get fed up with your life. You need to get fed up with your circumstances. You need to start thinking, because your thoughts will control your feelings, that I am tired of the way that I've been living. I'm sick and tired of being sick and tired. I'm tired of the same old problems happening day after day. I'm tired of the same old fights happening time after time after time. I'm too stressed out. I'm too unhappy, too anxious, and too depressed. I am too overworked, and I am too busy. And if you have found yourself complaining about any of those things, this is for you. You need to say, you need to think to yourself, I have come to the end of my own strength. Because the sad and the hard truth for all of us is that our best thinking and our best actions have gotten us to the very point we are in life right now. You got to get desperate if you want to change. You've got to get hungry. You got to start starving for more than you have right now. Because if you're not, nothing different will happen. Nothing will change until you get a little dissatisfied or a whole lot dissatisfied with your life. And if you're sitting there thinking, whatever. I'm fine. Life's fine. Everything's fine. I don't need to change. I mean, I don't have the time or the energy to do anything anyway. And if that's you, then you have my permission to just check out for the next 7 weeks, all right? Because nothing will change for you spiritually until you get with God and you understand how desperately you need him. Until he gives you the gift of desperation and the willingness inside of you to do something at long last finally comes up. I can't tell you how many times husbands and wives come in my office and it's just too late. They should have come years ago. They should have done something years ago. And now everything's falling apart and everyone's quit on everybody else. And if they'd have just come when they had the chance, something different could have happened. The prodigal son wasted it all. He had nothing left. He was desperate. He was hungry. And only then did he finally come to his senses. Have you come to your senses yet? It's okay if you haven't. God loves you. God will, he'll let you sit in your mess just a little bit longer if that's what it takes. And while you're sitting there, he'll send a little bit of rain your way. And if that doesn't get your attention and get you a little bit desperate and want some change, he'll send a little bit more rain your way. And if that doesn't work, he'll send a storm. And my friends, you don't want a storm, do you? But God will send one. God will send a storm your way and it will rock your life. God let me sit in my alcoholic mess for 9 years before the storm became so great and so bad and so frightening that I finally came to my senses. You see, God loves us too much to see us waste the abundant life that is available for each and every one of us just by sitting around and letting us squander our lives doing whatever makes me happy in the moment. He loves you too much for that. Because he knows, like Michael said, your selfishness, you getting what you want all the time, will ruin your life. Now, you know that old phrase. Say it with me. You can lead a horse to water, but you know what you can do? You can put salt in that horse's oats and make him thirsty. Amen? And my friends, God will salt your oats. Because the first step in transformation is to get you thirsty enough that you want more. Thirsty for the living water that only He can provide. We see in Jeremiah, God say this to us. You will seek me and you will find me when you seek me with, say it. All your heart, not a little bit, not half-heartedly. God wants all of you. And until we're willing to commit that, we're not going to have any change in our lives. Now the next step after getting fed up is owning up. Owning up to my sin. When the prodigal finally came to his senses, he realized that it was actually insane for him to sit there penniless and homeless and starving. Because just down the road, I have an incredibly generous and wealthy father. My friends, it is insane for anyone on earth to do life without God, because our God loves everyone and His resources are unlimited, and yet so many choose to do just that, live without God. And it's even more insane for Christians, because we sometimes choose to live without God's resources even though we believe in Him. Isn't that insane? Doing life your way on your terms. This has only created all of your problems. Why don't we try doing it His way? Because when we do life on God's terms, it unlocks the secrets of this universe. It unlocks His peace and His power and His provision in our lives. But you can't get there without doing what the prodigal son did. The prodigal came to his father and he said, I have sinned. When we own up to our sin, God unlocks things, but we have to do it before the transformation can occur. Isaiah, we read, it's your sins that have cut you off from God. It's because of your sins that He's turned away and won't listen to you anymore. My friends, if you feel far from God, guess what the problem is? Your sin. It's you who've moved away from Him. You've adopted some idol. You've given your heart over to yourself or your comfort, to wealth or your job, to vanity or success. Maybe it's sports. Too many sports, right, ladies? Too much shopping, right, gentlemen? We pursue whatever makes us happy in the moment. And my friends, there's nothing wrong with any of these things. They're not bad, but when they come before God, when you put them first in your life, when you say, I can't do the church stuff because I got to do all this other stuff. I can't put God, I don't have time for that because I got to make time for all these other things. Your life will end up in ruin. You're as close to God as you choose to be. And the way to get closer to Him is through confession. King David, he decided he wanted something that he shouldn't have that was against God's will. He wanted this beautiful woman. And so he decides, you know what, I'm not going to do it God's way, I'm going to do it my way. And he cuts himself off from God, and in doing so, he damages many lives, and he has adultery with Bathsheba. And after this, after his life is in ruins, after his heart is all torn up and he can't figure out, how am I going to keep going, he writes these words. He says, have mercy on me, God, according to your unfailing love, according to your great compassion. He needs God to be bigger than him. He needs God to be more forgiving and full of love than David himself is. Blot out my transgressions. Wash away my guilt and cleanse me from sin. I know I screwed up. My sin is always there. I can't deal with it anymore. I've sinned against you. I knew that you had a better way and I chose my way. God, help me. He doesn't make excuses. He doesn't blame other people for his problems. He just accepts his place. He accepts his guilt. He accepts his sin. And he says, God, take it from me. You were right, God, and I was wrong. And how does God respond? God tells us when we confess to him, he says, come, let's settle this once and for all. He says, though your sins were like scarlet, I'm going to make them white as snow. Though they were red like crimson, I'm going to make you white as wool. This is the great stain remover verse of the Bible, my friends. This is OxyClean for your soul. Amen? When we humbly bring our sins to God, rather than saying, oh, he forgives them. He removes them from us as far as the east is from the west. Now make no mistake, it cost Jesus everything to be able to do this for you. But he did it. He did it because of his great love for us. The third thing that has to happen for us to come back to God and experience intimacy is to offer up myself, offer my life and my will, my total being to the care of God. Let's look at how the prodigal son was transformed. This self-centered man, the younger son, told his father, "I want my share of your estate now, before you die." But he was transformed. He was transformed into one who said, "I am no longer worthy of being called your son. Please take me on as a hired servant." My friends, his heart moved from absolute self-centeredness into total God-centeredness. And that is what true transformation is all about. That's what these 7 weeks and all the months that follow can be about for us, moving from a self-centered life into a God-centered life. Are you there yet? Is God at the center of your thoughts and your job and your relationships and everything that you do? Or are you still, gimme, 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 my, me, mine, now? Have you ever prayed a prayer that said, "God, make me your servant. Let me do your will for a change, not my will. And then give me the power to carry it out in my life." And my friends, this doesn't happen overnight. I made the decision to surrender my entire life over to God 6 years ago, and I am still a work in progress. I have come a long way from where I was, but I have a long way to go. Even Pastor Ray has a long way to go, if you can believe it. We all have a lifetime of learning and change ahead of us if we're going to turn our lives over to God, because he is way far out front. Amen? But that change starts with the decision to turn your will over to his will. To say, like the prodigal son, "God, make me, change me, transform me." And if this is you, if you need some of this, some spiritual health in your life, I've got some really good news for you. Because all week long, you're going to be learning about and talking about spiritual health if you're in a small group. And our very own Chuck Schutte, in just 7 weeks, is going to start a life transformation group. And that group is going to go through the 40 days of purpose, where you're going to discover why God put you here on earth in the first place. And that's going to be the beginning of our 90-day experiments, where we figure out, what do I need to start with, God? We're not going to ask you to change all 7 things overnight, but one at a time, we're going to say, "God, for 90 days, let us focus like a laser beam on this one issue. See what you want for me instead of what I'm doing. And then I'm going to just ask for the strength to do your will, God." And I promise, if you do that work, your life will change in ways that you can scarcely imagine. The last step for us here today is our response to what the Father does when we get fed up with our lives, when we own up to our sin, and when we offer up ourselves to him. Just like the son, he returned home to his father, and while he was a long way off, Dad saw him, he came running, he got the ring and the fat calf and the robe and all those wonderful things, and they began to celebrate. My friends, when one sinner repents, all of heaven rejoices. God hears your confession. He knows how many mistakes you've made, how bad it's been. But when you bring all that to him, he not only forgives you, but he rejoices, and all of heaven with him. And the only logical thing for us to do is to join in. The fourth thing we must do is lift up my praise. Life becomes a party when God transforms you to his way of seeing and doing and experiencing life. And there is only one way to join that heavenly party. Psalm 100 verse 4 tells us. It says, "Enter his gates with thanksgiving and his courts with praise." This has for me become a life verse, my friends. I can't get enough of this because I want to be close to God. It says that I enter into his gates. If I just want to come close to him, I got to come in a little bit. And I do so by saying, "God, thank you. Thank you." Every morning I wake up, I say, "Thank you for Sarah. Thank you for those 2 kids who are downstairs eating all my food. Thank you for this beautiful house. Thank you for this job. Thank you for bringing me to Decatur, Illinois, out of San Diego in the middle of winter. Thank you, Lord." And I come closer to him and I begin to trust him a little bit more that today is going to be a good day too. That he's going to be God today. But I want all the way in. I don't know about you. I want into the Holy of Holies. That phrase said that I enter into his courts with praise. And in the Old Testament, the courts were around the temple. And in the temple, there was a place by the altar, and past the altar, called the Holy of Holies, where the Ark of the Covenant was, and God's glory dwelt between the wings of the cherubim. That's where he was. And if you wanted to get all the way in, you had to come into the Holy of Holies. And that tells me that I get into the gates with thanksgiving, but I come all the way into the Holy of Holies through praise. And praise, all you Lutherans, means this. Clapping your hands, singing loudly, sometimes moving around a little bit and dancing. This is what praise is. And we are ushered into his presence through praise. Psalm 68, say it with me. Sing to God, sing in praise of his name. Extol him who rides on the clouds. Rejoice before him. His name is the Lord. So stand up on your feet. And we're going to get a little bit spiritually healthy right now. We are going to praise our God who rides upon the clouds.